Greetings, this is another flashlight review by the flashlight reviewer Selfbuilt. Today I'm looking at the latest high output light from Acebeam, the K70. This is part of our long established series of lights from Acebeam. This one looks actually very similar to the last one I reviewed, the K60, in terms of a very similar build. In fact, I have the K60 right here, which I just sort of put up side by side. As you'll see, exterior styling is very similar. There's a few changes here in the head with some anti-roll features, which are kind of appreciated because the old K60 could roll quite easily. So that's kind of helpful. You can see them there again on the fins and the head. They've also updated the control ring so that you can see now there's more of a raised effect. So you can see there, there's raised areas that were not there previously on the K60. But otherwise, the light is pretty much very, very similar in its overall styling and size. Works the same way, same sort of interface, a clicky switch at the tail, rotary control ring with very clear detents to various modes, some of which are illustrated on the ring. Basically, there are 6 output levels with a standby and a strobe mode. So the arrow on the ring tells you what mode you're in, so you know before you activate the light, strobe, standby, or highest level there, 6, going down to level 1, which is the lowest level. The difference to the previous model is this is a very large, smooth reflector now, and there's an XHP35 High Intensity at the base. So you can see it there. Try to bring that in a little bit closer for you. So that's a relatively small emitter. The HIs, or High Intensity XHP35s, are a very small die size. So you should get outstanding throw for this while still having very, very good output. The previous K60 was an XHP70, so this XHP35 will give you less overall output, but will give you a phenomenal throw. And you'll see full numbers for that in my review. Basically, this is the furthest throwing single emitter light I've tested so far, non-modded light. So that's actually very impressive, the stock shipping model. Overall output measures are a little lower than the Acebeam specs. I usually find pretty good concordance with Acebeam. In this case, there's sort of a consistently, I find in my testing, about 15% less output than claimed at each of the measures. That could just be maybe using lumen estimates instead of ANSI-FL1, I'm not sure. But I actually find further throw than listed in the specs for the light. So again, I recommend you check out my full review for all the numbers. But the output of light is clearly extremely impressive. Inside, the light is built the same as any other light, recent light. You can see there's a spring in the head. There's a battery carrier, so you use your own cells. The battery carrier looks pretty much exactly the same with some slight labeling differences to the one I reviewed in the K60. The 4 cells appear to be in series. The carrier is reversible, fits either way. You can see there in the tail cap, maybe I'll just get a little bit more light there for you. So you can see there's a double spring. There's an inner and outer spring as before for transferring the current path and involving the switch. This is, again, very similar to the previous models by Acebeam. Not much has changed here. You have anodized screw threads, which are now square cut on this model. But that doesn't really matter here because it's actually the tension on the springs that control whether or not the light will work. If I turn it on, for example. It does tend to start. I stand corrected there. It does tend to shut off immediately when you loosen the battery. So sometimes you'd have to do more of a quarter turn. In this case, just a slight turn is enough to get the light to shut off and lock out the light. So there it is, lowest level. You can see that is, you know, fairly low. As you go up in outputs, a little hard to do this one-handed. Let's try it this way. So there's level 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Now, of course, my camera here is auto-correcting for the white balance and overall intensity, but you can see it gets quite bright. It's quite warm on the hand. There's the standby mode, and there's the strobe mode as you keep turning. So all the modes as you'd expect. So quite a bit of light. Let me just take it back down to the lowest level so we can take a closer look at the... here, let's get that out of the way. So the lowest level is extremely low. It's kind of like a moonlight. So let's go up to the level 2. Gives you a better idea of what to expect in terms of a hotspot. Now that's a foot off my desk, and you can see there's obviously a darker inner area. That's to be expected on a thrower at really up close range. If we take it up to about 3 feet off my desk, now you can see the hotspot is a little bit more even. Still slightly dark in the center, but again, we're not fully focused at this point. Very sharp hotspot, very little corona. Take it back down, increase the level. You can see the spill beam. Fairly smooth spill beam. There's some slight obstructions on the edges due to the crenellated bezel. But again, you don't really notice those in real life. But it is a very smooth beam. It's a very even overall spill beam. Very sharply focused corona. And again, if we take it up to sort of a higher level, let's bring it up to level 6. You can sort of see that up close. Tint isn't quite as purple in real life, but it's always hard to show tint on these kind of cameras. If I go back up to about 3 feet off my desk, that's a very bright hotspot. It's incredibly, actually, I find it, to be honest, it's such a bright hotspot that indoors when I was testing this light, it's really too bright to stare at the hotspot reflected off the white walls of my office. So I knew I was in for a heavy thrower when I saw that. You'll see the full numbers in my review. Again, it actually exceeds specs. It's an incredible amount of output and a very good beam at a distance. And so again, you can't really see that here. You'll have to see the outdoor beam shots, especially in my full review, to get an idea of how it performs. Runtime patterns, again, very similar to other Acebeam lights. One difference is that the K60 light was only recommended to be run on high drain rated batteries, so IMR batteries typically. In fact, the K60 came with a set of Acebeam 2500 milliamp hour IMR cells. The K70 doesn't come with batteries. They do still recommend that you run the light on IMR, high drain, but they do allow protected cells now, as long as you're using high quality cells with a good quality protection circuit. I've tested my standard keep power 3100 milliamp hour batteries, which are based on the Panasonic core. They seem to have a pretty good protection circuit, and it worked fine in my testing. But it is something to keep in mind, especially if you want to run the light on turbo. They do recommend higher drain. It's just not as required as it was with the XHP70, which is a very high output, high drain type light. The XHP35 High Intensity doesn't drain the cells quite as hard. So you can probably get away with protected cells in many cases, which I always recommend. Like the K60, it does have a low voltage warning and the light begins to flash as the batteries start to drain. Eventually this becomes more and more noticeable, and so you can, you know, change the cells yourself. You're not likely to over drain the cells unless you really aren't paying attention, which is, I think, a good feature to have in a light that's recommended to be used with unprotected cells. So very straightforward. Most of my comments on the K60 apply here as well. I like seeing some of the build updates though, like the anti-roll and the easier to access ring by touch alone. So it's very easy to find even in the dark. If we look at the package that comes with it, sort of a standard kind of Acebeam box. Looks like it can come in different color anodizing, which I know is the case on the K60. Inside you get sort of the standard manual, which you can see here. Very straightforward, runs you through the full feature set of the light. Again, easy to use, nothing out of the ordinary there. It does come with a holster, which a lot of lights this size do not. In this case, it's a very simple belt holster that just kind of holds the head firmly. It's a kind of a cute idea, allows you to carry it on a belt without needing the full holster size. That's basically it, sort of standard kind of warranty card. Space for batteries, but none were included. Extra package that comes with the light is a very kind of standard sort of wrist lanyard, and of course you get the extra boot cover and the extra O-rings as well. So straightforward, nothing really out of the ordinary there. Kind of what you'd expect. Decent package, excellent performance, runtime very consistent, and again with what you expect, well regulated light. Basically no real surprises. Just incredibly impressive for the amount of output. So for that, I recommend you check out my full review where you can see the detailed runtimes, beam shots, and detailed beam intensity and output measures. Thanks for your time. I hope you found that useful. For a full review of this flashlight, including beam shots, runtimes, and direct output measures, please see my full review, which you can access at Candle Power Forums in the review form under my username selfbuilt, or directly from my personal website at flashlightreviews.ca, which maintains a master list of all my reviews, as well as background information on how I do my testing, and links to recommendations for different types of flashlights in different battery categories. You can also click on my logo on the top right-hand corner to subscribe to my YouTube feed, which will notify you for every new review that I post. Simply mouse over to choose to subscribe, or depending on the type of device you're on, you can click and go to my YouTube homepage and then subscribe to my channel feed there. Thanks for your time. Hope you found this all useful.